cast in us the hope of glory.
Thank you.
price of life has never been so low. There has never been a night when more are seeing and dreaming, and all that Jesus paid was with the love of all mankind. So in a time of rain, we will ask for rain. In the rainy season, we will dance again. Let the earth rejoice, for the bride has found her voice, with heaven's waters falling on us all.
Thank you.
Many waters cannot quench this love that you have bought us with, oh God. Even death will never separate us from your holy power. How beloved, words are not enough to tell you of our love. We adore. Many deaths can never separate you from this holy power. So we come again, just like the day we first saw. Your powerful love that has lifted us up. You are more than just a crutch. You're my arms, you're my legs, and you're my feet that keep walking. You are more than just a feeling. You're the sureness in my soul that keeps me anchored. How could I go wrong? How could we go wrong? When I imagine on that day, before all time stood still, my blood encrusted Savior God fulfilled his Father's will. between his life and death. The one who holds all things in place released his final breath.
Yeah.
take it all again. You will always have my whole heart. Take it all again. You will.
Locate us so beautifully, Lord. You take us to where you are. You take us into heavenly places. You take us into the realm where heaven and earth become one. And we thank you, Father, that you've come close to us. As we've drawn close to you, you've drawn close to us. And we thank you for the mighty presence of your Spirit. Thank you for your angels that cry, holy, holy, holy. Worthy, worthy, worthy is the Lamb that was slain before the earth was made. We feel somehow, Lord, that we've found that realm this morning where the angels sing, where the cloud of witnesses watch. See how you come among us. And thank you for that. Thank you for who you are, Jesus. Thank you that you went down, Lord, and that you conquered death and the grave. That you took the keys of death. You took the keys of Hades. Oh, that you conquered it, Lord. Once for all. You conquered it once for all. 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 Ha, ha, ha. Once for all. It is finished. Bride. Jesus. Thank you, Lord. I don't know what you expected to feel when you came to church this morning. But the Bible's so good. It says that he's able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that you could ask or imagine. And If you've been imagining good things, if you've been imagining and hoping and asking for good, the Lord says to you this morning, I can do more. I will do more. I will do more. I'll do more. I'm the resurrection king. I'm the resurrected one. I'll do more. I'll do more. I'll do more. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
I just feel like somebody here today has got a father who's really, really not well. And so we just want to lift that person up. And I just want to speak health to his whole body. I feel like you're actually sitting in this meeting and you're wondering how he's going right now. We just want to release peace over your whole family at this time, that this will be such an uplifting time and a time of connecting again. And so whatever that means to you right now, we just want to release healing. We release healing oil to your family and to your own heart, your own soul, and what it means for you to go through that at this time. And Lord, we just want to thank you that every single situation in this room, every single relationship is coming under the gaze of heaven. It's coming under the unction of divine power. You have divine power for us, Lord. You're not just a name. You have a divine name that is above every name of every disease, every disorder, every distress. And we just thank you right now just for your grace to come. Come and comfort. Come and put your arms around every single person that needs to know that it's going to be okay. We just thank you for that right now in Jesus' name.
Well, he is risen. Come on. Come on. Come on. I'd do something if I knew what to do. But why don't you greet someone nearby, say Happy Easter, and you can be seated. Thank you. It's good to have you with us this morning.
Good morning, Jubilee. Just wanted to let you guys know that if you're a visitor, if this is your first time, or maybe it's your second time, and you haven't met some of the team, or you'd like to just fellowship and have some free coffee, we have a visitor's lounge that will be available in the cafe straight after the service. So there's some couches, there'll be some snacks. Thanks, Simon. Please avail yourself of that. Okay. If the team could take up the offering while we're doing the announcements, that'd be awesome. Thanks, guys. And the building fund, of course. Very, very excited about our building fund. Okay, guys. So, as some of you may know, the Create School will not be on this week because it was our finale last Wednesday, which went incredibly. But it will be starting up again on Wednesday the 29th. And we will have Amanda Wells with us. So I don't know who that is, but it sounds like she has a well full of revelation to share with us. With a name like Amanda Wells, you can't go wrong. So that's very exciting. And then Harp and Bowl will be on, and it will be on this week as well. Correct? It's on. So Harp and Bowl is not stopping. At 7:30 in the hall, of course. Then this Friday night, we have Nightlife Equip, which I will be running in the cafe for all you young adults. So if you are between kind of 16, 17 to 25-ish, then we would love to have you. If you do not know about that, please come and see me afterwards, and I'll give you some more information. Then we have the Easter parade tomorrow, guys. Who's pumped about that? A few of you. Awesome. So we've added something. I know we said dress colorfully, but we thought it would be fun if some of you want to join in. Some of us will be wearing onesies. Seamless comments. It's the same. Jesus wore a onesie, apparently. Yeah, so if you would like to wear a onesie with us, I know it might be a hot day, I'm not sure, but it will be a lot of fun. I'm going to be wearing a unicorn one. You guys can wear whatever you want. If you don't have a onesie and you would like to get one, there's some Asian stores in Bondi Junction, kind of in the, you know, Oxford Street in the outside mall? Just there, you can get them for like $15 or at Target or a bunch of different places. So that will be a lot of fun. I'm pretty sure the whole band will be wearing onesies, so we'd love it if you would join us. Yeah, if you'd like to register, they want us to register, I think, just so that they know attendance. We have a group called Jubilee Church, so if you register at sydneyeasterparade.com.au, just register under the group Jubilee Church so that we can all kind of meet together. That's it. If the kids could go through, that'd be amazing. It's very quiet. Okay. Go for it.
Awesome. Thank you. I'm not preaching today, but I just wanted to give testimony, and somebody else is just going to also speak. But just welcome to all of you. I know you've been welcomed. You're welcomed again. You're doubly welcome. We just have some testimonies of some of the words of knowledge. I know we've had healings, and we've also had lost things found. And do you remember some of you that were here in the meeting last Sunday night with a folded piece of paper and a book that was really important? Well, it was actually a death certificate that went missing, and it was found in the bookshelf, in the book. Like, so awesome. Thank you, Jesus. So if you have something missing right now, ladies, it could be a piece of jewelry, it could be a ridiculous thing that you think, why is that important? God is into finding things. You're ultimately his greatest find. Let's face it. He's found you. He's keeping you. He's not losing you. But I really believe that it's one of the ways that he actually shows us that the little things do matter, because that's how... When we actually realize how the little things matter, then the little things in other people's life matter. So you might know somebody that has something missing right now. We're just going to lift it up. In fresh air, it looks ridiculous. It sounds ridiculous. But I promise you, we are finding amazing things. Another lady found her engagement ring. So, Lord, we just thank you right now for the return of things lost, for the return of children, the return of goods that children had, return of favor that left. The return of deals that got crossed off, weren't signed. We just asked for a return of papers that were missing, signed documents. We just thank you, God, that every lost item, every lost thing shall come back in Jesus' name. Amen. And before Finn comes up to preach, we've just asked Dennis to come and share with us a very special. I really want you to open your hearts and listen, because it's tended to speak about encounters that we have personally, but I want you to receive this because I really believe it's powerful for us all. Thanks, Dennis.
Two nights ago, I had this dream slash encounter, and it was like I was just standing in front of a theater, in front of a stage. It was about a meter high, and I was just looking in front of it. And as I stood there, I just instantly just got drawn across and into the stage, like, I just knew it was the presence of God, and my arms just were thrown up, and just like there was magnetism, I was just drawn into his presence and just across that stage, and it was so unreal. And then I went and had another dream and a heavenly host, and I won't go into that one. But then I come back again, and I was standing at the same spot in front of that stage, and the curtains were all the way drawn down, and it was just a few inches. The curtains, there was a gap, just a few inches between the stage and the curtains, and I could see Jesus just standing there, and I knew he was standing in front. of like a host of people, just ranks and files, organic and organized, and I could just see his feet, you know, and I just thought, I need a regenerative healing, like badly, and I just thought, if I could just touch his feet, you know, and I just thought, you know, it just would be strange, the guy is standing there, touching him from behind, and, you know, at his feet, and so I didn't, and perhaps I should have. And next minute I come back and I'm sort of standing over here and I'm trying to look under the curtain. I just wanted to see him. I just wanted to see what was going on. And as I did that, I was just looking. Instantly the curtain was drawn and he was looking back at me like this. And he was so pleased. You know, he was so happy. He was a little bit cheeky. He had a perfect balance of all that, unlike myself. And... I just instantly, my hands were raised again. I just was drawn up into the heavenlies and I just, like it was magnetism, I just straight up. And then I woke up and I was just lying there and I was just like undone. You know, I was just quietly sobbing, just thinking, you know I need a healing, but more than anything, I just want to be in your presence, you know. That's just so much what I need. And I just was in and out of like, it was dark, and then sometimes later it was light. I've just been in and out of that for so long, and it's just, I was just unbroken. I was just broken, you know, and I just sense that I seen the feet that Peter, when he had Christ in his house, he didn't see those feet, but there was a woman who did see the feet, and they're the feet I seen. They're the perfect feet, and it was just unreal.
Come on. This is the church where you get messed up.
I just want to release one more thing. Come on the back of this. This is Dennis. This is the first time. I mean, I've known him for years now, and this is the first time I've heard him speak about that. Those of you who have actually thought it's just for those crazy girls and, you know, the crazy mystical arty types, you know, it's all fun for them to have visions and see. If you want to have an encounter like that, just hold your hands out. And just say, God, I want to be that desperate. I want to be that hungry. Because God is visiting his people and he's revealing himself in all kinds of ways. And he will reveal himself to you because you long for him. He longs for you much more than what you long for him. So Holy Spirit, we just want to thank you. We want to frame that. We want to say thank you for visiting houses in such a real way. For coming to our great needs, Lord, whether it's healing or whether it's healing of heart or body. We just thank you, Jesus, that you are reviving us to a place of desperate hunger for you, that your presence is all that we would want. So we just thank you. We expect you, God. We expect the inbreakings, the curtains. We expect you to come behind the things that we thought you were always behind. We just thank you that you unveil our eyes so that we can see you high and lifted, the glorious King. We love you, and we find that so precious. We want to honor you in Jesus' name. Amen, amen.
Come on. Wow. Well, I got a couple of testimonies as well, and this could be this morning. I was in Cairns last weekend and helping a new church plant, which was just such a privilege. I was there at the birth of the church 30 weeks ago, just a dozen people in a boat house of a university kind of club, and beautiful people. And now, 30 weeks later, this is the second time I was visiting them, and the church had doubled, and there were some really significant people visiting. And we had a meeting on the Saturday night, and so I led worship because they haven't got any musicians yet. And I got to preach on the year of freedom, the year of Jubilee, which is our kind of core message. And at the end of it, I said to them, is anyone here in excruciating pain? And a lady straight away put up her hand at the back, and I'm told afterwards she's the wife of a Qantas pilot. They were both there together, hadn't been in church for years. This is her first visit to church for years. Just become a little bit disenchanted with church and hadn't gone anywhere for years. And so that was her first visit. She was in such pain, apparently, that she was going to leave the meeting. She couldn't make it through the worship, but she just kind of hung in there. She was very uncomfortable, constantly shifting in her seat. And I sat her down. There were about 40 people present, maybe 45. And I said to them, as you do when you take a risk, I need you to watch what's going to happen now. You know? Because you can't be a witness if you haven't witnessed anything. You know, the reason why the disciples were so bold and went out after the day of Pentecost is because they were witnesses. They had seen the risen Christ. They were witnesses because he had walked through the walls and had eaten fish with them on the beach. They were witnesses of the resurrection. People very seldom will give their life for what they believe to be true. No one gives their life for something that they don't believe to be true. They had seen the risen Christ. That's why they gave their lives. Anyway, I called them around and I said, have a look. And so I measured her legs, and one of her legs was seriously out of whack, probably about 2 inches shorter than the other. And she was in a lot of pain when I prayed for her. So I just said, look, rest of you, come gather around, have a look, watch. Because if you see what's going to happen, then you're going to see it change, and you can be able to tell people about it. I saw it happen. Then you can be witnesses. So I just said, I'll close my eyes. You'll keep your eyes open and close my eyes. In 1 minute, that leg just shot forward. She was surprised. We were all like, wow. She stood up. She said, all the pain's gone. Come on. Come on. She came back to church on Sunday morning, and I said to her, how are you doing? Because often, you know, you can have that in the moment of the emotion, you get caught up and there's like something happens, you know, but you're not sure, will it last? Well, Sunday morning she woke up, she had no pain whatsoever. And she said what was amazing was that she had some other conditions that she hadn't spoken about. They were women issues, and those were totally healed as well. Come on. Come on. And I asked for who could show their hands as to who else was healed, because we prayed for a number. I got then everyone asked to pray for each other. I didn't pray for everyone because that's not a good model. Jesus sent out the 70 and said, you guys go and do it now. So I got them to pray for each other, and there were 10 other healings that night. 10. 10 other healings. Amen. So this is the reason why we're talking about these things this morning, is because it's the day that we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And there was something very, very true, very moving, very powerful about the fact that only He has the power to change lives supernaturally. It's that resurrection power. It says in Romans 8 that if the same power that raised Christ from the dead dwells in your body, He'll quicken your mortal body. And that word quicken is to give life, to rejuvenate, to restore, to make alive. So the same Spirit that made Jesus alive is the same Spirit that today is making us alive. All we have to do is say yes. All we have to do is to get into the beam of His love and just open our hearts. And so, as a part of this morning's message, I've asked Daryl to come and share with us, because he has an amazing story of recovery from incredible addictions and things, which he'll go into this morning. And I think it'll edify you powerfully. We did it at the morning service at 9, and it touched so many, many people. We had a few druggies actually come into the service and actually listen, which was quite interesting. Come. Let's welcome Daryl.
Thank you very much. Isn't it a great day today? Yay, God. Love Easter Sunday. Well, it's a pleasure to be sharing with you. How many of you were in the morning service? This is still the morning, isn't it? The 9 a.m. Okay, not very many of you. Okay, I'm going to give you a brief account. I'm going to keep it as brief as I can. Account of my life. What God has done in me and through me. Over the last little while, it's been an incredible, incredible journey. I have had many movements and changes in my life, and yeah, I hope you can be blessed. So let me just begin by telling you just a brief history of my childhood, or a little bit of my background. So first of all, I was born in a place called Northern Ireland. If you've heard of Northern Ireland, a great place of quite remarkable conflict through the 1980s. So I was born in Northern Ireland, and at 3 years old, my mum and dad got divorced, and I was then sent initially to live with my mum, but I was in a dual custody thing. So I was with my mum through the term, went to school, and then in the holidays I was with my grandparents and my father back in Northern Ireland. So I was a frequent flyer, back with a little tag from the age of five. So in the midst of that, living with my mum, she was on a quest to find her new husband. And in the midst of that, she actually never married again, but in the midst of that, you can imagine that I had many father figures come through my world. And so eventually, as I was going to primary school and everything else, by about the age of 9 or 10, we had a reasonably permanent guy in our house. His name was Tim, and he took me kind of under his wing and looked after me until the age of about 12. The only thing was that Tim was a heroin addict. So we had we're going to be mentioning a bit just about functional alcoholism, functional drug addiction. Now, he was a functional heroin addict, meaning that he had transitioned onto methadone, and sometimes I think he still used heroin, but he was working full-time. So he had a full-time job, and he was able to function reasonably, but you can imagine that his temper went up and down quite quickly in the house. And so I lived with him until the age of about 12, at which stage my mum had had enough. She broke up with him, but he still lived in the house. So he lived in the house. Then we had other guys coming over. And in the midst of that, I had my bedroom there. And let me just say at this stage, I'm about 13 now, that because my mum was English, she Indian English, and she grew up very properly, hugging and loving isn't necessarily part of the passed on tradition of English parents. And so I don't know if it was just because she was English or emotionally broken, but I would say that she probably said she loved me, and I wouldn't be exaggerating if I said 3 times, ever. And talking hugs, possibly 3 or 4 in my life. So probably 3 or 4. Now, I don't remember past 3, but no hugs. And so I developed a condition where I rocked myself to sleep every night until I was 18. So you can imagine I'm quite emotionally unstable, and people would comment, why does he just rock himself to sleep? So at the age of, and it does get better, trust me, this is just, goes a bit downhill and then it gets better very quickly, which is really, really cool. So I was in a position where I was living with my mum, and she got a job in London. I was living in a place called Ipswich, and we moved 50 miles east into central London. And I moved with her, this when I was 14, and we moved into a very, very rough neighbourhood. And the neighbourhood was so rough that in the mornings before I went to school, I would have to cut my face with a knife. Because if I could cut my face with a knife and develop any kind of scabbing on my face, I got attacked less when I went to school. It looked like you could fight and you were left more alone. So it was an interesting scenario. And I thought the only solution to this was to join a gang. So I joined one of the local gangs when I was 14 to 15. And we moved in with, my mum then moved in with another guy who was one of the regional gang leaders. And so we had shotguns in the bedroom. I held my first shotgun when I was 15. And he taught me at that stage how to deal speed. So I learned in the house, I didn't include this in the bit in the morning service. But what happened was, then I was part of a gang. I started to learn to what it was to take speed and do and sell and take drugs, pot. And then at that stage, I found it easier because I was still emotionally so disturbed, so broken. I found the easiest thing for me to do was to drink alcohol. And alcohol literally became a savior to me. It wasn't a legitimate savior, but I started to drink a lot of alcohol. And I left home at 15. I actually ran away and moved in with my grandmother back in Ipswich, and then just proceeded to drink and drink and drink and drink. And so when I say that I was an alcoholic at 15, when I would go to the toilet, I would pass blood. That was really common. That was normal. And I knew if I stopped drinking for if I left it one day, then the blood would stop and then I would start again. So I literally just rationed my alcohol and how much blood I passed in the toilet, which isn't a good place to be at 15 years old. And so at 16, my mum, I started to get in trouble with the police and various other things. And at 16, I got sent to live with my father in rural Northern Ireland. So I've gone from central London, right bang in the middle, heart zone one of London, to rural Northern Ireland. So where there were subway trains, there are now cows. There's no exaggeration. And at 16, because it was so rural, there's no public transport, effectively, and I hitchhiked. So you've heard stories of people hitchhiking. I hitchhiked 14 miles a day for 2 years, every day. So I hitchhiked down in Northern Ireland with an English accent as an alcoholic. God protected me. I hitchhiked to college and back. Now, in the midst of that time, I started to do a lot more drugs. I was feeling even more isolated. My dad was, my dad at that stage was, he did the best job he could, but I was extremely rebellious. I would have drugs sent from England in cassette tapes, and then I would distribute them in Northern Ireland. I was very, and that's a really bad thing to do in Northern Ireland. It really is. And so any country, but in Northern Ireland specifically, because you can be shot by the paramilitaries. So then when my dad found out, it was a whole upheaval in the house. But what I'm saying in that is that my alcoholism never stopped. I was what you call a functional drug user and alcoholic, which basically means that I could sit and have a conversation with you, I could go to college, I could do my schoolwork, but in my spare time, I spent my time dampening my pain and hurt. And I did that by, in the morning, I would get up and drink some whiskey, and then most mornings, I would have a mixture of whiskey and cocodamol, which was a codeine-based painkiller, and I would have that before I went to school. And so, or college at 16. And so I did that for 2 years. In the midst of that time, I started to get heavily into acid and ecstasy. But primarily what happened was that I developed something called paranoid schizophrenia at that time. So what happened is that there were people living in my head, and I've had, at that stage, had my first alcoholic seizures, which basically meant that, I don't know if you know anything about alcoholic seizures, but when you don't drink alcohol, your body withdraws. And if you drink a large amount of alcohol, it's extremely dangerous for your system. And so I would stop drinking, and then I would isolate myself. I felt a seizure, I was so embarrassed, but then I would have these alcoholic seizures, and then the only way that they would go away was what? Just by drinking more alcohol. So I was in this cycle at 16, 17, where I was doing so many drugs, and I was in a cycle of alcoholism where literally it was lending itself to me going into incredibly crazy stages of mental breakdown. At that stage, if someone had said they had done any kind of psychological analysis on me, they would have put me in a mental home, absolutely 100%. There is no way whatsoever that they would have kept me out at that stage. So it does, it's okay. Everyone's like, are you okay now? Okay, I'm good. And this is the way you have to bring a testimony, because you need to see the extremity in order to be able to feel and see the resurrection power that comes through as a result. And so I'm there, I go then to uni. Remember, I was functional, put myself into uni. When I arrive at university back in England, I feel like I understand now. I don't understand. I get quickly into cocaine, because the cocaine buzz was really the thing of university. So I started to take and sell cocaine, and I thought that was a good idea. That became my drug of choice, which wasn't any better, obviously. And I burnt both my sinuses out and actually had an overdose when I was in uni at that time. So year 2000 comes, and I'm struggling immensely. My dad's writing me letters saying that he doesn't believe that I'm going to live till 21. Prior to that, most people said that I would die at 18. So that was what I lived in. So I literally had a countdown. It was actually quite hard to escape that. So I literally thought, my dad wrote me a letter and said, if you carry on like this, you will die. So I took myself to AA, went into AA, and the guys in AA said, you're going to die. So I was like, okay, great. Does anyone on my side right now? At that time at university, I started to become influenced by many Christians. There was a lot of Christians in my world, and they were absolutely aggressive in telling me about Jesus. And I can tell you right now that really, really helped me. So never have a go at anyone who's too aggressive in that. It really did. I needed that straight talking in order for me to actually snap out of some of the things that I was in. And so I had one girl specifically who was from a place called Manchester, and her name was Lizzie Bettany. She actually looked very, very like Izzy. She's really Italian, short, very curly hair. And she grew up in a place called Manchester, and some of you will know, Manchester's very, very rough. And basically, I met her at university. She was part of the Christian unions and everything. And God put me on her heart really, really strongly, so much so that she would end up writing massive letters to me and sending them to my house in London. I remember one time I was sitting in a bar in London, she rang me and she said, I'm coming down from Manchester to just stay with you in I'm just going to come and hang out. And she just sat in the bar with me, and I'm sitting drinking in the bar, and she's sitting beside me. I'm like, why are you here? First of all, you've got guts sitting. Like, it's, you know, you don't come from Manchester to London, sit in a bar with a guy that's selling drugs that you don't really overly know. And she's sitting there, and she goes, I'm here because God told me to come down and share with you the gospel. So literally, she's sitting here, and I'm in the bar. I just couldn't escape. I was like, okay, I get it. So my 21st birthday comes, this is the year 2000 now, and I'm still in the midst of doing all of the crazy stuff. Remember, I've still got delusional, paranoid schizophrenia at this stage, which I'm trying to navigate as best as I can, all completely self-medicated. Never went to a doctor, nothing. Self-medicated, took myself into rooms, talked to myself until I felt a bit better, had a drink, and then came back out. Hey, how are you doing? Yeah, good, thanks. Are you good? I don't know. How are you doing? Like, it was a lot of, there was a lot of people in my world, and not all of them were real. And so I started to think about the things of God. And at this stage in the year 2000, on my 21st birthday, I was selling ecstasy, and I started to take some pills on my 21st birthday. I took 7 because I didn't think that they were working. And I rang the dealer, and I was like, why aren't these working? And I was with all these boys, and they said, oh, just go, take it easy, they're slow release. And I was like, so I overdosed that night. And I had a really, really, really significantly bad experience. So much so that I was saying to the guys, you need to take me to hospital, and none of them would, from fear of repercussion of taking me. So I literally had to just sit it out, and I don't want to think about that. So I am healed, though. So I'm in this situation in the morning. So this is my 21st birthday. So May the 7th, the morning after my birthday, I get on my knees in my bedroom, and I know, remember, I've had Lizzie and all these Christians going, you're going to get saved. And I'm like, okay, yeah. And I get on my knees, and okay, God, this, they've all been talking about you. Just take my life right now. Just take it. Do something with it. I don't know what else to do with it. So I stood back up. Didn't feel any different. Went to the pub, had a few beers. I said, okay, we're on the way. Now, what happened at that stage was I continued to sell drugs. So I was living with drug dealers at the time. And so I continued to sell drugs. But what I did do differently is I started to go to church on a Sunday. Now, when I was in church, you've got to remember that I'm struggling, a struggling alcoholic. So I had a prerequisite that any time someone wanted to take me to church, and I'll get to even more events that I went to, I would have a criteria that they would say that I was allowed to drink there. 100% true. So what would happen is that I would go to church. I actually never went to a church service without having an alcoholic drink before, after, or during. And that's 100% true. I felt so judged by the people in the church. I used to sit on the back row, and I'd have a can of special brew, which was really strong, up my sleeve. And when no one was looking, I would make sure that I drank it. If people were around and I couldn't drink, I would take myself out to the off license, down or neck a couple of bottles of beer, and then come back and sip. Remember once I was in a crusade, and they took me to a crusade. They said, he'll really get saved if we get to this crusade. And they took me to a crusade, and they got me a seat on the front row of an outdoor crusade. And I was on the front, and I had this can of beer in my arm. And I was like, and I can tell you right now, do you know how crazy it is that this year and last year, I was on the front row doing crusades in South America. I was on the front row because I was the speaker. And I'm serious. And years before, I was on the front row because they just really needed me to hear the gospel well. And so I was 1 foot in, 1 foot out. I was still doing a lot of drugs. My life was absolute chaos at that time. Crazy. So I moved in with a girlfriend. I was living with my girlfriend in London. And so we had an apartment there, and I would spend all weekend just doing cocaine, cheating on her, and then coming back and going, hey, how are you doing? Yeah, I had a great weekend. And then going to church on Sunday. So it was an interesting scenario. And every time I reached out to be discipled, and I'm not speaking bad of anyone, no one, it was very difficult. I would sit down and tell them my story, and they were like, whoa. What am I going to do? Sorry, I can't help you. And what happened was I started to have less connection with church then at that stage. And I said, okay, God, you're the only one that I don't even know what to do. You know, I'm trying to reach out. I don't know what to do. And so I was in my bedroom, and I said, God, and I'm kind of jumping eras a tiny bit, but I was in my bedroom, and I said, God, okay, if you're real, show me an angel. I was extremely suicidal at that time. I literally thought I was going to kill myself. And I said, if you're real, show me an angel. And I went to sleep that night and I woke up and there was a hazy cloud. When I woke up at 3 o'clock in the morning, a hazy cloud at the bottom of my bed. And I thought, and I'd done a lot, I was used to hallucinations. So I was like, wow, okay, it's another hallucination. But it felt so clear and I felt so peaceful. And I said, well, if this is a hallucination, this is a good one. I'm enjoying this one. And because some of them could have been extremely negative. And so I looked down at the cloud at the bottom of my bed, and clear as day, clear as a person, I saw a wing, a 6-foot wing, flapping like a bird's wing in the middle of this thing. It was unbelievable. And I remember waking up in the morning and trying to, the first thing I thought was, well, that was an interesting experience. I didn't forget it. It was like seared to my heart. And I thought, oh, that's an interesting experience. I wonder if it was just, and I was just about to fob it off as an experience from my mind or my heart, and an audible voice came into my heart. It was the first time I heard God speak clearly to my heart. And he said, last night you asked if I was real and if I was to show you an angel, so I sent one. And I was like, I was there, and I was like, wow, okay, you are real. So I rang some of the local churches, actually, just because I was seeing billboards on the... So I was the wacky guy, functional but wacky. So I rang some of the billboards and I said, hey, because they'd have billboards telling you about Jesus in the city that I was living in. And I just ring the number and they said, ring this number if you want to go to church. I go, hey, I feel like God's speaking to me. Is that normal? And they'd be like, yeah, it's normal. We'll come and collect you. And I, you know, went to various African churches and all these different random places where they would hammer the ground, and I was like, it was just bizarre. I took myself into some very interesting scenarios and trying, searching, desperate to find this God that had sent the angel into my house. And so it was starting to get really, really extreme, and it was already extreme. Remember, I was still struggling with alcoholic seizures at that time. I haven't given up alcohol at all, just to let you know. And my body's starting to really suffer. I'm actually really feeling mentally not 100%. So I'm taking myself into AA a little bit if I can, and trying not to do as much coke as I normally would do, like just trying to cut it out a tiny bit. I started then smoking crack, which didn't help the whole mental scenario. And then found myself in a position where I would just continually smoke crack rocks as well, as because it was quicker. So I'm in this scenario, and we're coming into the great, fantastic, awesome good news. And so I'm in a scenario where my girlfriend's just had it, and she said, that's it, I'm over it, leave, whatever. And I just get very, very low. I find it really difficult to break any cycle that I'm in whatsoever. I'm trying to reach out to the church. God's on my case. You know, I can feel that there's something going on, but I just didn't know what to do. And I just knew that if I got myself to Australia, I would be away from my troubles. I literally thought, I just kept on thinking, I was walked to work, there was a big sign up, and it was a countdown to summer with a beach in London, and there are no beaches near London. So it was like throwing a carrot. I'd be like, oh yeah. But I did watch Home and Away and Neighbours, and I knew that there was a better life in Australia. It's true. I used to get stoned and watch Home and Away and think, wow, one day. But I really did start to feel like there was something stirring in me for more, and I'd broken up with my girlfriend. Then one day, just around that time, coming towards summer, I had a phone call, and I had two of the men that had fathered me, they both died. So what happened is one of them had a brain hemorrhage in the bathroom. He was the one that said, I will look after you no matter what, and I'm really going to come in as your father. So he died suddenly from a brain hemorrhage in the bathroom. And then Tim, the heroin addict that had brought me up, committed suicide. So I was in a situation where I was like, okay, my life's pretty bad right now, but now I just feel like, oh gosh, what on earth am I going to do? Like, I'm just over it. I'm done, finished. I don't know what to do. So I'm walking through a graveyard feeling sorry for myself. And my mum rang my phone and she said, what's going on? What do you need? And I said, I just need to get out of here. I just need to go and live in Australia. And she said, actually, I've just come into a windfall of finance. I'll finance you to go. Just go. I said, okay. So I just needed a confirmation from the Lord, because I was half in, half out. So I was saying, okay, well, should I go to Australia? And I had the Christians going, no. Some of them said, yeah, go. Some of them said, don't. But they said, if you go,
get yourself to Hillsong Church. That's all that they knew of Australia. They just needed me connected somewhere, you know. And so I went into a park called Christchurch Park, and I went up a big hill. And I said, okay, God, I know you're real. Shall I go to Australia? Give me a sign. And I walked back down the hill, and I kind of forgot about what I had asked. And there was a guy sitting on a bench at the bottom of the park, and he said to me, I said, hey, how are you doing? And I said, why are you upset? He looked really upset. That's why I went over in the first place. And he was reading a book. And he was reading the book Down Under by Bill Bryson with a big picture of Australia on the front. And I was like, wow. I said, what's wrong? And he said, I've just sent my daughter to go and live in Sydney, Australia. And I'm feeling a bit emotional. I said, well, that's my confirmation. I'm going to go. So I get the money, book the ticket. This is a very, very abbreviated version of what happened. You've got to remember at this time, I'm still passing blood. I'm still drinking every day, and I'm still battling mentally more than you could believe. It was extreme sometimes. I developed something at that stage just beforehand called chronic agoraphobia, which basically meant that I couldn't leave my house. It was a psychological symptom of taking too much ecstasy. And so what would happen is to go to work, because I worked, I was reasonably functional, to go to work, I would have to plan my route because I needed to be able to hold on to things. Because if I could hold on to something, I could breathe properly. So I would walk into work and I would find a lamppost and I would hold the lamppost. And then I would run and I would find another post or a bench and I would stand. And because any open space, I thought I was going to die. It was an incredibly strange experience. And so in the midst of all of that, because I want to draw you into kind of where I was mentally, in the midst of all of that, I've got this ticket now booked to Australia, and none of my friends think I'm going to go. I'm saying, I'm going to go and live in Australia. They're like, yeah, right, you know, you're off it. And so very soon after that, I got on a flight and I came to Sydney, and on the flight, some of the guys that were on the plane said, you just need to go to Bondi Beach. And I was so excited. And I had some money in my pocket, and I just thought, wow, when I get to Australia, I'm going to get so smashed. I'm going to get so smashed. I'm going to make so many friends. I'm going to get so many girls. It's going to be amazing when I get to Australia. And so I got to Bondi Beach. I flew in. I got a taxi just down the road from here. And I started a drinking binge for 21 days. And that 21-day drinking binge took me into hospital. I would wake up during the 21 days. I was staying just down in Bondi Beach, and I would have wet myself numerous days. And in the midst of that, I didn't eat or drink any water. And so I got, after the 21 days, I went to the Bondi Hotel as I would in the morning. I would shake so aggressively at that stage that I knew something was going on. It was extreme. So I couldn't even take myself in the shower to wash myself from the pee before going to the bar, because if I didn't do that and I didn't have a drink, the seizure was going to come. So it was I actually became probably the worst alcoholic I've ever seen or known, and it was me. So I got to a stage, I was drinking there 21 days, and at the end of the 21 days, I took myself into the Bondi Hotel. I took in for the drink. Stunk, I hadn't eaten anything, and I was starting to shake, and I ordered a schooner of beer, and I started to get black flashes come all around my head. And I'd never had that before. I'd had hallucinations before. I'd had various things happen, like crazy stuff, you know, really not okay mentally, but this was different. And I was like, there are black flashes coming and surrounding me, and I don't know what this is. And I went to go and grab the schooner, because I thought, if I drink this, maybe the black flashes will stop. That was my answer normally. And a voice said to me when I was sitting up at the chair, if you drink that beer, you will die. If you drink that beer, you will die. And I know that wasn't the voice of the enemy, because he would want me to drink it, obviously. But I'm saying, the voice said, if you drink that beer, you'll die. And I knew when I left that morning, I knew to put my passport in the back of my pocket. So in my back pocket. So it's funny. So I went out of the bar. I didn't touch it. I was like, oh, wow, I don't want to die. And I was still having the flashes, and I ran to the outside, and there was a taxi, and I said, can you take me to the ER department? And they took me to the ER, and the guys, as soon as I walked in, they grabbed me. I don't know what was happening. I don't remember anything from then. And they grabbed me, and they put me, I don't even know what they did. I just remember being in an ambulance again, and then I woke up 3 days later. And so I woke up 3 days later, there was a heroin addict next to me, and I was I was in a bed and I was really thirsty and I was saying, you need to get me some water. And the heroin addict was going, you need to get me some drugs. So we were just like shouting abuse at the staff there. And at that stage, so I just lay on the bed. As soon as I'd woken up, not many minutes after, maybe 5-6 minutes after I'd woken up, and I had a vision. And in the vision, I saw it's like the vision landed on me. I can't describe it apart from I got baptized in the vision. That's what it was like. And suddenly I was looking at a wall and a dog had a collar, and the dog jumped over the wall and hung himself over the wall. And then I saw the Father, and I knew it was the Father, even though any vision you have with God in it, you know it's God. And the Father got his hand and scooped me up. And as he did, he then at the same time untook the leash off my neck, or the dog's neck, and he said, have you had enough yet? And I came back to, and immediately I knew what I had to do, and I stood up, and I just needed to be by myself. But suddenly I had an instinctive knowledge that there was a chapel underneath the church, underneath the hospital. So I just took myself out, went down the stairs, took myself, and there was a chapel there. There was no one in there. And I walked into the chapel and got on my knees at the altar of the chapel. And I said, God, take the alcoholism from me. Take everything from me right now. I want to be a Christian. And I'd done this before, but I can tell you right now, I said, I want to be a Christian. I want to follow you. And a fire fell, and I know it was fire, fell and baptized me from the top of my head to the sole of my feet. And I literally became a different person. And so much so that when I went upstairs, I went to the nurse, hey, how are you doing? And she goes, we're releasing you right now. Look at you. You're completely, it was incredible. And so I got released and I went back to the house where I'd been doing drugs and drinking and hanging out with the guys. And they, all of them, even a year later, were sending me emails saying, whatever happened to you that day? Like, they had no idea. And from that day, I never, ever craved an alcoholic drink ever again. Ever. I never... And I gave my life when I was 21, right? I got on my knees. But it was... I believe that that was the day that I got truly born again. And so when I got back up and I went back to Bondi and I was still living in that place, and within 3 months... And I started to go to a church. Within 3 months, I knew that I was supposed to be in ministry. I just knew it. I knew I was supposed to be a pastor. And I rang people from the UK that had been praying for me for all those years. And they said to me on the phone, I was going, I'm speaking in tongues and everything. Like, I'm really into this now. And they said that one family, they've been praying for me since I was 5. And they said that when they first met me, the Lord had told them that I was a pastor. And so all my life, this is 100% true, 18 years they had prayed for me, for 18 years until that day, weeping on the phone and saying, God always said that you were a pastor, or called into full-time ministry and going to work as a pastor. And so within a few weeks, I was in Bible college. Within 2 years... of finishing Bible college, I was in full-time ministry, another church as a pastor, and then transitioned now. I've been 7 years working as a pastor here. So God has just done some amazing things, and it's been an amazing journey. God is good.
Come on. Grace of God. The grace of God. Wow. How beautiful is that? Anybody not believe in Jesus? See, because that's the power of the resurrection. It's the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead. And you know, when I think of Daryl's journey and how he was rocking up at churches with a schooner or with a can of beer tucked into his sleeve and maybe a bit of whiskey on the side and maybe a few tablets in his pocket. We got people that come to Jubilee like that. Come to church stoned. We had a couple in the 9 a.m. service. It's quite tricky speaking with that, but I just thought that's And if you're here today and you don't know Jesus, today could be the day. Because it does take many encounters with the grace of God. A friend, a neighbor, family member, Lizzie from Manchester, a letter, an email, someone giving you a book to read. They say it takes about an average of 7 encounters with the grace of God before people actually surrender and give their lives to Jesus. But it doesn't really matter. It could be your first time today. You can do it. You don't have to wait for the next 6. That would be silly, wouldn't it? But you see, God is so unique and Jesus is so special. Every other great world leader has a grave where there's a body. A bit dehydrated, but it's there. You can visit the tomb. I won't mention their names. Many great leaders, you can visit their tombs. Well, Jesus' tomb is empty. And that's what sets him apart from every other leader. And when he, on the night that he was betrayed, he sat down, it says, he sat down at the table with his 12 disciples and said, he took some bread, it was unleavened bread, it was the night of the Passover, because he was going to fulfill that which Jewish people had been doing for 1,500 years. From the day when God told Moses, tell my people to take a lamb that was without blemish. Take that lamb, keep it for 14 days, and then on the 14th night, shed that blood and put the blood on the doorposts and the lintels, that when the angel of death comes across the land of Egypt, all my people will be spared. Take bitter herbs. Take unleavened bread. The unleavened bread was because the leaven is the presence of sin. Leaven is the presence of sin and worldliness. And you're going to eat this in haste because the deliverance of the Lord is at hand. And that memorial went on. Bitter herbs, meaning the years of bitterness, the years of difficulty, the years of living in Egypt as a bitter people. They were homeless. They were nationless. They had no passport, no land of their own. They were abused for 430 years. But their salvation was at hand. And so Moses, for that first night in Egypt, they celebrated the Passover for the very first time. And then for 1,445 years, they celebrated every year at the same time. This weekend, they celebrated the Passover because it was the Lord's Passover. It was the Lord's victory that he took Egypt. He took them out of Egypt. He took them out of darkness, out of a place where they were ashamed, out of a place where they had no sense of self-worth, out of a place of where they were not appreciated, where they were abused every single day of their lives. They were given less and less mud to make their bricks with, less and less straw, and expected to work harder every day. But the Lord brought about a great deliverance. And so it's an important time. And so Jesus didn't randomly choose the night that he was betrayed. He didn't choose that night. He chose it because it was to fulfill all righteousness, that the lamb would be slain, the perfect lamb. So when John the Baptist looked at him for the first time, he said, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. So here's the prophet prophesying. Here's the Lamb of God. You can take a little Passover lamb, a little lamb. He represents the perfect lamb. That's the shadow. Here we have the substance. That's the type. Here we have the real thing. And so Jesus was fulfilling his very word when he said, this bread is my body. This cup is my blood. And the power of that has echoed throughout eternity. Countless, millions and millions of people have responded to God's love. Millions and millions and millions of stories just like Daryl's. My story is entirely different. I got saved at 15. I've never been drunk. I've never taken drugs. I don't know what he's talking about. But I need God's grace just as much to save me from self-righteousness, which is as filthy rags, as someone who's had an addiction or someone who's had an emotional problem or a mental issue, the same grace applies. It's just as miraculous that God can sustain me for 36 years of been knowing Him. Come on. And you. Come on. It's the same miracle power. And so we're celebrating His Passover today together as a fellowship, as a family. Because God's going to do some miracles here this morning. Romans 8, the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you. He will quicken your mortal body. For some of you, it's the forgetting of shame. It's the forgetting of the past. It's some of you have had something of Daryl's life, but others of you have had nothing of that, and you don't know. But you might need a miracle in your marriage. You might need a resurrection in your marriage. You might need a physical resurrection, something of a tumor or a condition that you need to be completely eradicated. It's the same power. You might just need love this morning. You know the first time that love appears in the Bible? Genesis 22:2. First time the word love appears is when Abraham took his beloved son, his loved son, his loved son, and offered him on Mount Moriah. And the father offered his beloved son on Mount Moriah. So this is about love. This is the story of Easter, is the story of love. It's the story of someone who didn't have to die, but he had to die. He said, no man takes my life. I give it willingly. It wasn't the soldiers that took him. He took himself. They didn't force him. He went there willingly. He gave his life. He laid down his life. And that power is here this morning to touch you. Thank you. To release you, to make your life so worthwhile that you'll remember Easter 2015. To make your life so significant that you'll realize that God took you. It wasn't just the world He died for. He died for Daryl and Belinda and Izzy and Dennis and Sonia. Come on. And you, James, as well. James, the beloved disciple. Put your name at the gospel. Put your name on the story of Easter. It's your story. And if you've had people that you've been praying for 18 years, just let's put our faith today that God's going to turn some situations around that you've been praying. 8 months, 8 years, 18 years, doesn't matter. God is able to turn things around in such a rapid way, in such a miraculous way, an angelic visitation, and a sudden interruption of the course of life, that God's going to do things today. And you're going to feel different because of it. Let's just bow our heads. If we could have the musicians up, that'd be great. Yeah. Holy, holy, holy. I'm finding it very hard to speak because I'm just overwhelmed with God's presence. Which I think is the perfect place to be. And God can take me out the way and do what He wants to do. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Firstly, I want to pray for people that maybe this Easter is your Easter of knowing Jesus. Either you maybe have never known Him, and a friend has brought you, or you found your way into Jubilee this morning, and you'd like to say yes to Him, because He knocks on the door of our heart, and we open the door. He doesn't push His way in. He never forces people. He's looking for a hunger. He's looking for a vulnerability. He's looking for humility. Or maybe you have known God and fallen away, and today is a reconnection with God. Either way, I just want to invite you to say today, I want to make that decision. And if that's you, just raise your hand. I'm going to pray for you. I'm not going to call you to the front. Thank you. I see your hands. Is anyone else? Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. And just put your hand up again. Thank you, madam. I see your hand. Is anybody else? Thank you, Lord. You can just put your hands down again. Can we just pray this prayer together with these folk that are taking a step over the threshold of unbelief and making a step of faith? It's a bold step. Let's just pray with them. Father, thank you for sending Jesus. Jesus, thank you that you came. Thank you that you took my sin. Thank you that you hung on the cross. Thank you for your shame, that you took my shame. Thank you for your humiliation, that took my humiliation. Thank you for your suffering, that took my pain. I receive you today as my Lord, my Savior, my God, my best friend. I ask you to fill me with the Holy Spirit and fire, that I won't be the same again. My whole life will be changed. The course of my life will change. In Jesus' name. Amen. Let's just praise God for new believers. A friend of mine leads a church in Pretoria, and I heard this week that his church, they're baptizing people every Sunday who get saved that day. I think we need to believe for a baptismal font. They baptizing 50 people every Sunday in church. Business people in their suits, they just get baptized. So if you have put up your hand today and you're not yet baptized, I'd like you to encourage to come and meet one of the team, meet one of the prayer team, and just say, I'm one of those people. Give me a time. Give me a day. We'll set a day for you in a Sunday, maybe 2 weeks' time. Go down to Bronte Beach. They built this beautiful pool, which is our baptismal font. And it's beautiful time to get baptized. Amen.
You know, when I had that encounter, when I had that experience with God, he didn't just save me, but he delivered me from alcoholism, from drug addiction, from paranoid schizophrenia, from high level mental illness. My whole body was absolutely rendered useless, and he brought healing back to my body. And I just want to encourage you, if you heard that testimony today and you are struggling right now in any of those areas, whether you might have depression, I was set free from depression, you might have some kind of ailment within your liver or kidneys. My liver was done, finished. My stomach was finished. You know that God is here today to bring healing. He's here to bring salvation. The word sozo is saved, healed, and delivered. And he's here to bring a full sozo to anyone that needs it here today. And so I just want to encourage you, if any of those areas speak to you, we'd love to pray for you today. We really believe that there is a power for deliverance. There is a power here today for freedom for addiction, a power here today for freedom from all mental illness. And so if you're struggling with any of those areas, come, receive prayer and receive power today in order that you would be set free from anything that you're struggling with in the name of Jesus. I'm just going to ask you to come forward right now off that. There's a hunger that determines freedom. So if that's you, just come right now. Just come. Come, come. If there's any of those, just come forward right now.
And if you need any conditions of illness, pain in your body, anything that's debilitating you, today is the day of healing. Just want to say that tomorrow we're going to be at Hyde Park at 10. Please join us. You haven't got to wear a onesie, all right, even though Jesus wore a onesie apparently. Just come. Just come with colorful clothing. We need you, because not everyone worships like Jubilee does, and we need some happy worshipers. You'll see why when you come, all right? So come and join us at 10 o'clock at Hyde Park. We'd love to have happy folk there joining and worshiping with us tonight. Izzy's preaching at 6, and otherwise we'll see hopefully many of you tomorrow at 10. God bless you folk. If I can have the ministry team up, please, quickly. We've got lots of folk who need ministry. I'd just like to you come and pray with us, please. Everybody on board, every ministry team member, please. We're going to have lots of prayer this morning. And some catches, please. James, can you come and catch for us? Mikey, we need you. All the ministry team, please, just come and help us pray for people. We don't like to have them...